Hey everybody, welcome back. I'm Seth Monahan, a guy who's probably lucky to still have a job after that last video, and I'm here today to teach you about common tone diminished seventh chords. We're going to start with one of my favorite pieces, Schubert's C major string quintet. These are the first three chords, and it's pretty clear that two of them are tonics. But what about that chord in the middle, in bars 3 and 4? For now, don't worry about what the chord is. Just listen to how it sounds, and in particular, notice how dissonant, how tense it is compared to the tonics on either side. So what is that middle chord? From the bass upwards, we've got C, E-flat, F-sharp, and A. And if we arrange those as a stack of thirds, we get an F-sharp fully diminished seventh. So let's take a moment to think about what we've learned so far about fully diminished seventh chords. First, as far as we know, their root is always some kind of leading tone, and that leading tone wants to resolve upward to another chord root. This is true whether they're native to the key or acting as an applied dominant. And second, as far as we know, they always take the Roman numeral 7 diminished 7 with the little circle thing. So based on what we've learned so far, this chord, whose root is F sharp, should resolve to G major or G minor. It would be 7-7 in those keys. But we're not in G, we're in C, so we might expect this to be 7-7 of 5. But we've got one little problem. Despite being spelled the way it is, this chord doesn't go to 5. Instead, it resolves to tonic. So we can't call it 7-7 of 5. But neither is it the 7-7 chord that normally resolves to C. That chord is built on the leading tone of C, so B, D, F, and A flat, and that one sounds like this. So what are we looking at? Well, of course, the title of the video tells us this is called a common tone diminished seventh chord, and we label it like this. It's spelled like a diminished seventh, and it sounds like a diminished seventh, but it resolves in a very different way than what we're used to, and it's named after the common tone it shares with the chord it resolves to. And that brings us to the main point of this video, which is that diminished seventh chords, it turns out, can actually behave in two totally different ways. So before we do anything else, we want to make sure we have a really clear understanding of those two behaviors, of those two types of diminished seventh chords, if we want to think of it that way. On the right here is Schubert's chord progression, which uses a common tone diminished seventh. And over on the left, I've recomposed it so that the diminished seventh chord resolves in the more conventional way, which is to say as a leading tone seventh chord. And we can start our comparison with a general point about voice leading. Notice that the leading tone seventh chord has no notes in common with the chord it resolves to. Every voice moves by step. This is always true, though there's one apparent exception I'm going to talk about later. Now, by contrast, the common tone diminished seventh already contains the root of the chord it resolves to. That's the common tone, and it's almost always in the bass voice. Now let's think about frequency and flexibility. Leading tone diminished sevenths are extremely common. They can resolve into pretty much any consonant chord in any inversion. So it's not hard to find 7-7s of 2, 7-7s of 3, 7-7s of 4, of 5, and of 6. They are high utility chords, and they're everywhere. By comparison, common tone diminished sevenths are pretty rare, especially before 1825 or so, and they almost always resolve into just one chord, a root position tonic triad. Then there's the question of spelling. Now, it's plain to see that these two chords are spelled exactly the same way. But the spelling carries different implications. Here's what I mean. For a leading tone diminished seventh, spelling is destiny, specifically because its root is a leading tone, and that root wants to resolve up by half step into another chord root. Here, the root is F sharp, and it rises by semitone into G, the root of the 5 chord. This diminished 7th chord can't be spelled any other way. And I'm saying this because some students think that diminished 7th chords are just a kind of enharmonic free-for-all, and they'd be just as happy to see this chord spelled with, say, D sharp instead of E flat. It sounds the same, right? So what's the difference? Well, with leading tone sevenths, this is wrong. Spelling it like this makes D sharp the root, meaning that it should resolve into some kind of E major or E minor chord. If it's gonna resolve to 5-6 here, it has to be spelled with F sharp as the root. In 7 diminished 7 land, spelling matters. But with common tone diminished sevenths, spelling really doesn't matter at all. Schubert spelled this chord F sharp A C E flat, but he could have spelled it with a D sharp instead of E flat, and it would make any difference. It would do the same thing, and we'd label it in exactly the same way. But there's more. Because you can spell it multiple ways without changing what it is or what it does, we can't really say that it has a root, because if you think about this, roots are determined by a chord's spelling. And since it doesn't have a root in any meaningful sense, it doesn't get a Roman numeral either. That's why we just use C, T, circle 7. And then finally, there's the question of function. When they resolve to tonic, which is most of the time, I hear common tone diminished sevenths taking on something like a subdominant function, which I'll show here with a yellow S in quotation marks. If you want to know why, we can compare it to one of the most common subdominant progressions, which is 1 going to 4, 6, 4, and back. I'll play them for you twice and listen for similarities. And again. Now, why do they sound similar? Well, I think there's two reasons. First, both chords, 4 and the common tone diminished 7th, they both have scale degree 1 in common with the tonic chord. And here, that tonic note is in the bass throughout. That's really important. Second is the fact that the common tone diminished 7ths often put scale degree 6 in the spotlight, where it can audibly resolve to scale degree 5 in the tonic chord. As we saw in video 20, that's also very common with 4 chords. Now, one last thing before we move on. In making these comparisons, it can be helpful to think of there being two quote-unquote types of diminished seventh chords, the common tone type and the leading tone type. But you have to understand, and this is crucial, the difference between these types lies entirely in the way they resolve. There's nothing about any particular diminished seventh chord in and of itself that tells you whether it's one type or the other. In other words, you can't know the type until it resolves. And to illustrate this, I offer you the following thought experiment. Imagine the great Johannes Brahms wrote the first 2 bars of his 3rd symphony and then just dropped dead from, you know, beard poisoning or something. Now, poor dead Brahms only gave us 2 chords here. F major, the tonic, and this big diminished seventh chord, B, D, F, and A flat, with F in the bass. Now, in this admittedly tragic scenario, we would have no idea how that second chord was fated to resolve, so we wouldn't even be able to label it. But thankfully, Brahms did manage to finish the 3rd bar and all the other bars of the 3rd symphony, and if you know how it goes, you know that bar 3 is another tonic chord. So the bass stays on F through all 3 chords, making this the most famous common tone diminished 7th in the entire Western canon. So, before we start wandering through our usual gallery of musical examples, I want to go back to the Schubert Quintet just to finish out that wonderful first phrase. We already know how the first 6 bars go. and thankfully, the bass line of the next four bars tells us almost everything we need to know. The bass dips from tonic down to scale degree 7 and back, which is obviously a dominant to tonic motion. And then it rises chromatically from 4 through sharp 4 to 5, which we could justifiably expect to be a diatonic predominant, an applied chord to 5, and then finally 5 for the cadence. But, notice that Schubert doesn't go directly to the cadential 5 chord. It's preceded on the downbeat by a really dissonant pile of notes. That pile of notes has two parts. There's a dominant pedal point, and then above it, the very same diminished seventh chord we saw in the opening. F sharp, A, C, and E flat. But now it resolves more conventionally. It's acting as 7 diminished 7 of 5, resolving to the 5 triad on beat 3. So what's cool is that in this one excerpt, Schubert resolves a single diminished seventh chord both ways, first as the common tone type, and then later as the more familiar leading tone type. Finally, here is how the whole thing sounds. So at this point, we've got two things left to do. I want to play you just a few more examples of common tone diminished sevenths, and I want to talk about the one very important exception to that rule about leading tone sevenths and common tones. But first, some examples. This is from a choral piece by Leo Delibes that I stumbled across last year, and it uses common tone diminished seventh chords in the most conventional way. We're in E flat major, and Delibes starts his phrase with a long tonic pedal that has fully diminished seventh chords, resolving via common tone into root position tonics. And notice that Delibes is using a different spelling than the one we saw in Schubert. Schubert spelled his common tone diminished sevenths with lowered scale degree 3, but Delibes uses raised scale degree 2 instead, and it doesn't matter. It's the same chord whether you use F sharp or G flat. Also notice the accented non-chord tones that come in with each common tone diminished seventh. That D natural is scale degree 7 here, and it resolves downward into scale degree 6, which is a chord tone. That's a dissonance that composers really seem to love, and it's cool because it makes a complete D dominant seventh over the E flat pedal tone. Here's the entire phrase. Our next example takes us back to Schubert for the sixth moment musical for piano. We're in E major here, and the example is a long pedal point progression that comes after an authentic cadence. When I play it, notice that there's a little five chord loop that Schubert plays twice in a row here. We'll zoom in on that when we're done. So here's that loop up close, and it gives us a chance to get out ahead of something that often confuses students. In the past few videos, we've actually learned about two different diminished seventh chords that resolve into tonic over a tonic pedal. So let's make sure we understand what they are and how they're different. The first one here is the common tone diminished seventh that we've been learning about today. One of its four chord tones is the root of the tonic, E, which is held in the bass. But then in the next bar, we have the diminished seventh chord built on the leading tone of the tonic. Here that would be D sharp, the leading tone, plus F sharp, A, and C natural, all over the tonic pedal E natural. That one has a dominant function, and to my ears at least, it has a rather mellower sound over the tonic pedal than the very bright common tone diminished seventh. Now, what if you happen to be the kind of overachiever who wants to be able to tell those two apart by ear? You can do it by focusing on how we move into scale degrees 3 and 5 in the tonic chord. Do we approach them by half step from below, as in the common tone diminished seventh? Or do we hear those same scale degrees approached from above by half step, as in the leading tone diminished seventh? So now I want to talk about two less common situations, and we're going to see them both in the Schubert song Das Sie hier gewesen. The first of them is when a common tone diminished seventh chord resolves into an inverted triad. This happens in the next system, but we need to look at the first eight bars for context. The first half of the phrase draws out a single diminished seventh chord embellished with accented non-chord tones. The chord itself is B natural, D, F, and A flat. That makes the root of the chord B, which wants to resolve as a leading tone to C, C major or C minor. Since we're in B flat major, that means the chord is probably 7 diminished 7 of 2, and as you can see, that's exactly how it functions. When we go ahead to the next system, we find that that same diminished seventh chord, B, D, F, A flat, is on the next three downbeats as well. But this time, it's only the third one that resolves like 7 diminished 7 of 2. The other two times, the chord resolves to a second inversion A flat major triad, which I hardly have to point out is a weird chord to find in B flat major. For the sake of expediency, I'm just going to call it flat 7-6-4, even though that's not a thing, and this is really more like a half-hearted nod towards some other key, but whatever. The thing to notice is that it's the product of a common tone resolution. The root of the triad, A flat, is a chord tone in the previous diminished seventh. It's only on the third pass that one of the chord's tones resolves as a leading tone. And from there, it's all fives and ones till the final cadence. So when I play the whole thing, notice in particular how long Schubert makes us wait before actually giving us a tonic chord. It's hard even to know what key we're in a lot of the time. Wonderful. Now, later in this same song, we see the other exceptional situation, which is when a common tone diminished seventh resolves into a 5-7 chord. Listen carefully to the downbeat of the last bar. Notice notice first how the voice leading of the common tone diminished seventh is a little different here. To resolve into 5-7, all of the upper voices move upward by half step. And for that reason, I'm actually interpreting the chord differently than those prior. To me, the common tone diminished seventh here sounds like an embellishment of 5-7 rather than as a really independent chord. So I've analyzed it with figured bass and colored the notes B, D, and G sharp in red to mark them as non-chord tones, more specifically as lower neighbors to C, E flat, and A. That means, technically, we don't even need the C, T, circle, 7 label because the figured bass already accounts for everything. All right, last thing. Earlier, I told you that the most common type of diminished seventh chord, the leading tone seventh, resolves without any common tones. Here are the chords we were looking at, and you can see plainly that the only diminished seventh chord that resolves with any common tones is the aptly named common tone diminished seventh. The leading tone seventh resolves to its triad with no tones in common. This rule is technically always true, but there are situations where it might seem like it's not true. I want you to look at the opening of Beethoven's third Opus 31 piano sonata. It starts on an unstable predominant. Then it moves into 7-7 of 5. Notice the bass rising from scale degree 4 to raised 4. It then moves on to a cadential 6-4. And finally 5-7-1. This is all harmony we've seen before. But look at the moment when 7-7 of 5 resolves into the cadential 6-4. That E flat, which is also in the top system, sure looks like a common tone. This is our big exception. When 7-7 of 5 goes to a cadential 6-4, scale degree 1 will be a common tone. But this does not make the applied chord into a common tone diminished seventh. Why, you ask? Because, as we learned in video 24, cadential 6-4s are mostly made of non-chord tones. When that dominant bass arrives here, the E-flat above it is not a chord tone. It's an E-flat that's suspended from the previous chord and which will resolve to D, the actual chord tone, in the next bar. So yes, there is technically a common tone here, but it's not a common chord tone, which is what we usually mean when we say common tone. That's the thing you have to know here. Here's the whole passage. And the same thing is true when 7 half diminished 7 of 5 resolves to a cadential 6-4. Here is a lovely theme from Tchaikovsky's 6th Symphony. It's built as a slow sentence over a very long tonic pedal, and the basic idea just happens to feature that standard common tone diminished 7th progression away from and back to the tonic. But the repeat of the basic idea uses a motion to 5-7 and back over a tonic pedal. Then the continuation has some really wonderful chromatic harmony. It starts with 7-7 of 2 going to 2 over a tonic pedal. Then has 7-7 going to 1, still over the pedal. And only then does the bass line finally move in the lead up to the final cadence. It leaps from tonic down to raised scale degree 4, where we find 7 half diminished 7 of 5. And when that resolves to the cadential 6-4, we should expect to find a scale degree one, B natural, as a common tone. And we do, right there in two octaves in the bass staff. And here too, that scale degree one is a suspension from the applied chord over the dominant bass that resolves here into the leading tone A sharp. Here's the whole thing. That, my friends, is the end of the video. Somehow we ended two of them in a row with pieces named Pathétique. I think those are the only two, but if anyone knows a third one, I'll be glad to try and sneak it into video number 33, which is all about the 3 and 7 chords in minor keys. I'll see you then.